hello, malty monsters from Mordor. Yes, that's a malt mention. It was malt mentioned by Jim. Thank you, Jim, in London. And a bit of a Lord of the Rings fan, I suspect. Well, I've enjoyed reading the book myself, to be honest. And I've enjoyed reading a few whiskey books. Yes, not that many, actually. But I have read a few whiskey books. In fact, I own a few whiskey books, which I've found in the past to be quite useful in giving me points of reference for buying whiskey. Now, that's what this Whiskey Review 433 is about. It's about, well, it's entitled How to Buy Whiskey. And it may seem quite straightforward and easy and just matter-of-fact thing to do, but I encourage you to think a little bit more in detail about it, because it will help you make more selective and successful purchases if you think carefully about where you buy, what you buy. And what I'm going to do in this vlog, this whiskey review vlog, is not so much tell you how to buy whiskey as share how I buy whiskey. So I'm going to tell you how I buy whiskey, and hopefully it's going to be of some use to you wherever you are, because the opportunities and the options for buying whiskey does vary considerably around the world. And in the UK, in British Isles, we're actually rather spoiled for choice and opportunity compared to other countries like Canada, where tax and import duties and whiskies are so high and options are kind of restricted due to the controlling nature of governance. It's not just Canada. There's many countries around the world where options for buying whiskey are restricted, not so much by availability, but by what the authorities and people in power decide is going to be available and how much you're going to pay for it. And it's certainly the case that there are a number of countries around the world. I won't name names and I won't be specific, but if you're a whiskey buyer in that country, you'll know where I'm coming from. And basically, they impose import duty tax. And it all goes back to the whole Prohibition era, because although America introduced prohibition, and it lasted for roughly about 10 years, there were other countries, including Britain, which got seriously close to prohibition. And we're still living with that legacy in terms of controlling alcohol, because although it's legal, there are many who would consider a narcotic like tobacco, like cigars, and pricing policy helps to restrict the consumption and, the theory goes, manage the nation's health. Not entirely convinced, but I do agree that it's not so much about cheap liquor being available. It's about more expensive but quality liquor being available, but freely available. In the UK, in Britain, the first option for buying whiskey is at your local, what they call off sales. Basically, it's liquorist or bottle shop, however you want to call it, wherever you are. It's a shop which happens to be local, relatively small, and smell and sells alcohol. They will more often than not have a rather restricted range of single malt scotch, which may usually includes Glenfiddich 12-year-old, Glenlivet 12-year-old, probably some Jura 10-year-old, and if they want to be upmarket, they'll have Macallan, although there's less of that in these shops. These tend to be your local stockist, and if you're looking for a standard malt with a little bit of variety, then you won't be stuck. However, if you're looking for a little bit more variety, you're going to have to travel a little bit further where you are to the larger shops, probably supermarket. Supermarkets are quite useful sources of buying quality liquor because they're cost competitive generally. They don't have such a fantastic range, but you will notice, particularly before Christmas time or certain public holidays or Father's Days, they do have these special offers on the go, so that you may find that in their range there's one whiskey which has been discounted a little bit and has got a really good price. Now, I'll give you an example of that. In my local cooperative supermarket here in Isle of Man, just before Christmas holidays, they had Ardmore, the Ardmore traditional single malt, at £25 a bottle. I think that's a damn good price for the quality of what you're getting. I bought four bottles of that stuff. Better than money in the bank, malt mates, better than money in the bank. Now, once you go into the more urban environments, into your local city, you then, or a big town, you then come across the specialist liquor stores. Always interesting places to visit. And you will find this is at the point where you have someone behind the counter who probably has a good idea of what they're talking about, can advise you, and if they're not too busy with other customers, they'll make the time to chat to you about the different whiskies that are available, particularly ones you might not recognise. Ask, by the way, ask if you can get your mobile phone out and just take a photograph of their stock. They might be quite happy for you to do that. You can then go home and just kind of, without having to use pencil and paper, you can look at the photograph and then check up online for tasting notes, for reviews and all the rest of it. Very handy. If you've got a mobile phone, of course, you can readily access these Ralphie.com or Ralphie Stuff reviews online. And I tend to load up pretty quickly if you're getting a good mobile signal. And you can just check out there and then while you're in the shop. If you trust the specialist in these shops, it's always good to use some of your spending power locally. It's that old saying, use them or lose them. And the local specialist stockist of single malt whiskies, you really want to keep these guys going because they provide a form of competition against both the supermarkets and, of course, the online retailers who are becoming increasingly prominent. I'll come to them shortly. So basically, you occasionally you'll go into the shop, show an interest in you know, the guy behind the counter, what he's going to tell you or what she's going to tell you, and prepare to sort of examine some of the more unusual bottlings. There are some stockists in the USA is a good example, certainly in Britain, where your high street specialist in a city will actually bottle like a mini independent bottler, and they'll arrange for some of their own bottlings, and it's a matter of pride to them that they should be of reasonable quality at a reasonable price. They can be expensive. Now, this is what comes to my next point here. There are, particularly in Scotland, there are some boutique whiskey specialists whose prices are absolutely eye-wateringly expensive. You will find them near tourist areas where they're looking for the tourist pound or the tourist euro or the tourist dollar. And they tend to have quite a wide range of whiskey, even if it isn't particularly imaginative. But they certainly know how to charge. They can be very expensive places for buying whiskey, second only to distilleries themselves. Now, I know distilleries don't want to hear me saying this, telling you that a distillery is an expensive place to buy a bottle of whiskey. I would flip that a little bit and say, but distilleries are the places where you can buy the unique distillery-only bottle of whiskey, but don't pay too much for them. I'm not meaning to be a tightwad here, but if we budget carefully, if we focus on quality, it will filter through to the producers, and then they'll provide quality and they'll do so at non-rip-off prices. If the customer does not remain in control, the customer does not have control. And it's good for the industry. If you're a confident, happy customer like me, you buy more. Back to specialist whiskey shops, your high street retailers with nice shop window displays. You will find they don't really do a lot in the way of discounts at the time of year and all the rest of it. No worries, they're a great place just to hang out, have a chill and learn a bit about whiskies. Next, we're going to the auction houses. We're not quite online yet. Going to the auction houses. You can actually physically visit an auction or you can visit the online auctions. The choice is yours. You will find that it is the aftermarket or secondary market sale of whiskey. Beware of fakes, but if you are discerning and if you're clear about how much you're prepared to bid, you are in a position where you can pick up some whiskey that has been bottled years ago, where you know the quality can be really, really quite good. And it's a bit of an adventure going to the auction house. You're bidding, are you going to be outbid? When do you put your bid in? I do recommend if you have an opportunity to go to even a wine auction, just go down and observe, see what's trending, see who's bidding, see how the bidding's going. And certainly for whiskey, there's an awful lot to learn from that experience. You don't actually have to buy a whiskey auction to attend one. Online. This is where things kind of blow up a bit in terms of awareness, availability, accessibility, particularly in Britain. It's the online retailers. Now, they are kind of restricted by geographical area because of import-export restrictions and bureaucracy. However, the online is, you can get away from it. I mean, I'm sitting here with my computer. When I'm buying, I spread it around a little bit. I buy from my local supermarket. I buy beer mainly from my local neighbourhood liquor store. We don't really have a specific specialist whiskey shop in the Isle of Man, but when I go to Glasgow, I will go to my familiar environments. I don't want to give too much advertising here, but for Ralphie stalwarts, you'll know I'm talking about the venues. And I will make sure that I buy from these shops, 1, 2, 3, 4 bottles. But then I'm buying quite a bit online because I'm kind of isolated from the main shops, high street shops. And the postage, certainly in the UK, is very competitive in relation to the prices that online retailers are offering. The real benefit, the big bonus ball with the online retailers is that there's a bit of competition between them and they offer a fantastic range of whiskies and their own in-house bottlings as well. They feature the independent bottlers quite heavily, and that's important, so, so important, because increasingly it's independent bottlings which are becoming more prominent in my purchasing. What I do with the onliners is I'll just scan through the distilleries from A to Z. It takes a while, but it's worth it. I'll spot something. I'll spot a bottle of whiskey, and I want to know more about that. So I go to it for reviews at the main online review sites like Whiskey Fun or Whiskey Base, to name but two, where you can get single opinions or collective opinions, and they are opinions. I don't even bother referring to my own videos for opinions because you just don't do that. But I'll go to these sites. I'll see, what do these guys have to say? What do the malt maniacs in their monitor, what do they have to say? And then I'll kind of cross-reference opinions and marks. And then at one point I say, right, will I take the risk? Will I risk it for the biscuit? It's a big decision, malt mates. Sometimes it can be a bit swithering. But I recently bought some Kulila, the Gordon and MacPhail Kulila, which I'm really enjoying. Very huggable whiskey, this. I bought that on a hunch, and it's been a great success. Whiskies that I've bought recently, which I'll be reviewing shortly, include Balvenie 12-year-old, which has recently come out. The new double-matured Lagavulin, which I'm kind of not sure about. And, of course, one of my old stalwarts, going back to Springbank Distillery. Increasingly important to me is this nonchalant filtered 46% naturally authentically presented whisky, which is designed for the calibre of the experience. I know it costs a bit more. It does. But you're getting a bit more. So it balances itself out. But I don't forget, at the same time, there's some cracking blends out there like Vat 69. I'm looking at the full range, and then I'll explore other spirits. I'll see a bottle of whiskey. I'll just cut and paste the name into a Google search and just put reviews after it and then press send. See what comes back. It's a great activity when you're sitting with a dram, is to explore what's being charged for what's good value, what in this so-called whiskey boom is being discounted, because it's happening at the moment in the online retailers. A bit of money off this, a bit of money, not the sort of characteristic you would expect in a so-called whiskey boom. But it's when you're doing your research, you start to see the trends. And one trend I'm noticing, and I'm going to conclude my vlog with this, is there are competitive pricing for some whiskies out there. Glenfarclas 15-year-old, very good example of that, very good example. You get superb quality whisky at a reasonable price. That's one of the beauties of Scotch. It's, you know, it's out there if you're prepared to do your homework. Wherever you are, there will be something. And when you're doing this activity of doing research and checking out reviews and all the rest of it, you do notice trends. You notice that some independent bottlers with a particular whisky, they'll release a good cask, then a bad cask, a good cask, then a bad cask. They may release a sherry cask followed by a bourbon cask, a sherry cask followed by a bourbon matured cask. So you start to notice the habits of independent bottlers, and you'll notice the kind of the trends in the official bottlings. What's kind of the, where are they asking a lot more money than they used to? Where are the kind of the prices fairly static? I mean, a classic example is Glenelgan 12-year-old. What a superb single malt that is. It's a really tasty whiskey, and it's not silly, stupid price. It's not like Octomore, which Octomore is no longer a whiskey for drinking. It is a collectible commodity. It has a different value. That's just the way it is. And you can clearly see availability being restricted, which is encouraging that situation. Now, I won't bore you with too much detail here. I'm just sharing what I do when I'm buying whiskey. When you'd place an order with an online retailer, by the way, place a small order to start with. See, check out the calibre of the delivery, their packaging, their padding in the bottle, how securely they tie, cladding, packaging in the box, how securely they seal the box, how reliable the transportation is. And important, if you're out with British Isles, be very careful about ordering a bottle of whisky from within Britain, because you may find that once you've paid the extra money to get it exported to you, it can just get stopped in customs and you're getting hit with a massive import bill. You can take the risk, but it is a risk. And increasingly, it's a risk not worth taking. Finally, don't take it all too seriously. Even I make mistakes when I'm buying whiskey. I do. I take a punt on a bottle of whiskey and it doesn't quite work out. And what I do is I say, right, is it bad enough I'm going to complain? Or is it just a little bit bad that I'm going to start putting something else to lift it up a wee bit? Whether it be a bit of wood, some maple syrup, or another malt whiskey to actually blend it up. Options are there. Don't be afraid to try that. And I would conclude by saying, enjoy the moment, don't take it too seriously, and don't drink too much. As soon as you take it too seriously and get too wrapped up in whiskey and any other spirits, and you're drinking more and drinking even more, you can find that there's most nights of the week you will not be drinking just small amounts, but you'll be drinking 4 or 5 glasses. At that point, you've really got to discipline yourself to taking a night or two off just to give your liver a break, and drink plenty of water when you're drinking your whiskey. don't bother other people, and don't let other people bother you. I'm Ralphie. I have concluded my monologue on how to buy whisky. Well, how I buy whisky. I hope it's as convenient for yourselves. It's getting a little bit easier generally, internationally. Quite exciting as well. But there we go. Done and dusted. We'll see you soon for Whisky Review 434, which will be Balvenie 12-year-old single cask. Tasty stuff, you know. See you soon.